All right, how's everyone doing today? Day two. Hopefully we'll have better luck with the weather a little later with this rain stops. But I just want to piggyback off what Jack at Airwallex was talking about, and we're going to have SG Lee from Toss, which is a very exciting company out of Korea, which is, has started with P2P payments and expanding into other financial services verticals. But what I want to do today in the next few minutes is just walk through sort of what is a playbook? Is there a playbook evolving for how internet giants in Asia are sort of building and creating super apps within fintech? So starting maybe with one product and expanding all the way through into maybe starting with payments into wealth management, insurance, lending, and other areas. So if you look at a company today like Ant Financial, today Ant Financial is about $150 billion as of its latest valuation. If you compare that to some of the largest banks in the world as of their latest market caps, it would rank among the top 10 in terms of where their value stands. Of course, I think a lot of people think of Ant Financial as a financial company, and I think that may be sort of the wrong way to be thinking about it. If we look actually on the other side of the table, even looking at just tech companies, Ant would also rank among one of the top 10 largest tech companies in the world. So no matter which way you swing it, I think there's obviously Ant is a major force to be reckoned with. You heard from my colleague, Aria, who talked a little bit about what some of the other tech giants are doing within financial services. But of course, a lot of them are sort of single line going after payments and some other areas as well. But if you look at companies in China like Ant and Tencent, they've really built out this entire ecosystem of financial products on their platforms that they're offering to consumers. So we're going to talk a little bit about how did they do that, what was sort of the playbook to building that out, and how are they successfully sort of evolving for the future. So what does this playbook look like? I'm going to go through sort of step by step, but if we think about it sort of at a high level, originally it was really just to leverage the existing user base of platform users to expand into mobile wallets. As they did that and gathered more data based on transactions, a lot of features that were built out were aimed at locking in users by providing access to new features like money management as well as microloans. But now, as we think more about where they're headed now, it's really about building higher margin profiles through marketplaces that they're building out, and then also augmenting that with additional levers for engagement. So keeping people really using the apps and then cycling back into adding more users and thus more users who are adding more financial products on their platform. So let's talk about payments a little bit. If we look at China today, Alipay and WeChat Pay certainly are the two leading companies within China's sort of emerging cashless economy. And there's many reasons for why this happened. We can talk about some of them, but largely, if you think about Ant Financial as well as WeChat Pay, one was sort of the emergence of new features like peer-to-peer payments, the sort of red envelope feature for Tencent, probably the most popular, which has enabled a lot of people to exchange money to each other on Chinese New Year and other occasions as well as the transition to mobile e-commerce. So in about 2011, I think 15% of Alibaba's total transaction volume was on mobile. Last year it was about 85%. So certainly everyone is now buying everything they do on their phones, and that certainly helped propel Alipay as well. So payments certainly was the first part of this sort of flywheel and playbook. What have been some of the features they've added since? Certainly in the case of Ant Financial, I think Yuebao was probably one of the most important features that they've built. And this was sort of on the back of realizing that a lot of their users had a lot of idle cash sitting in their virtual wallets, providing a way for them to invest that cash into money market funds, which has emerged as the largest money market fund in the world, has become a little smaller since then, and we'll talk a little bit as to reasons why. But if you look at just the number of investors who are now on the Yuebao platform, it's about one-third of China's entire population. So pretty amazing stat if you just take a step back and think about that. Another area in which Ant has built out sort of a feature to lock in users and keep them engaged is in lending. They have three different lending products, both for SMBs as well as consumers. And a big part of this is just using that transaction data that they're gathering through the payments features and being able to do this well. So they've distributed about $13 billion in microloans to small businesses and also providing small loans to consumers as well. So another aspect of this idea of locking in users. But now as we think about where Ant is headed, it's really becoming less of a financial services provider and more as a platform and building out a marketplace for other financial institutions to sort of take place as well. So I think the big idea here is to think about Ant Financial as a platform for allowing other financial institutions to take advantage of their access to distribution as well as data. So today, I think the big thing here is that about 100 million users or over 100 million users are using all five of these functions that Ant has built out, whether that's wealth management, whether that's insurance, whether that's lending, as well as payments. And I think that's really important. I think that's going to build the business into a much more higher margin business as they think about building this into more of a marketplace and surfacing these products for their consumers. If we think about wealth management, for example, and maybe why we've seen some of a reduction in Yue Bao's sort of money market funds, they're now offering 116 mutual fund asset management companies on their product called Ant Fortune. This is a marketplace for wealth-type products. Have 180 million users. And again, it's all about driving margins by distributing products from other financial services companies on this feature. And so how are companies like Ant also keeping users engaged and coming back and building more of this profile in which they're also going back and buying more financial products? One is by adding additional levers of engagement. If you think about an app like WeChat Pay, certainly you're using the app every day multiple times, but Ant Financial, you may not necessarily be doing that. So having to continue to innovate to bring in users and engage with them. One of the features that's become extremely popular over the last year is this feature called Xianghubao, which is basically a crowdfunding platform for users to, if one person becomes falls critically ill, they'll be able to crowdfund payments for that. It's not necessarily an insurance platform, but certainly have reached users, almost actually 50 million users in less of the time than Yue Bao took to reach 43 million users when they launched the money market fund. So a very popular product, especially among China's rural population, and given sort of the state of medical in China as well. So where's the playbook going next? We're seeing this, I think, this same flywheel take place in other regions of the world. I'll go through just a few examples. Next, one is in India. We're seeing companies like Paytm also look to build out a model around starting as a mobile wallet and also emerging into other financial services, adding features such as Paytm Gold, for example, now building out a mutual fund investment platform called Paytm Money. And now, most recently, as you heard from Citi yesterday, launching a credit card with Citibank and features like unlimited 1% cashback. So similar type of playbook in what you're seeing that start with mobile payments, bringing a lot of data in, locking in users, and now expanding into other areas where they can build higher margins by offering brokerage as well as investment products to their users. In Latin America, we're seeing companies like Mercado Libre, which is very similar to Ant in a way because of the start with e-commerce, is one of the largest e-commerce platforms in Latin America, also look to expand their wallet, Mercado Pago, that's growing extremely quickly. And I think what's interesting in their case is it's growing extremely quickly off-platform. So a lot of users who are paying with their mobile wallet through QR codes in Latin America today using Mercado Pago. And similarly to Ant as well, also building out digital asset management tools and products like Yue Bao, and their first product, Mercado Fundo, is aimed at that. And again, locking in users to continue to use the mobile wallet. And in Southeast Asia, which is, I'd say, a bit earlier in its development, we're seeing companies like Grab and Gojek's GoPay wallet who are leveraging their ability to access the ride-hail use case as to differentiate from other mobile wallets in the region. And that's also enabled them to acquire users by using the drivers as offline agents, thus funneling them into, again, their ecosystem where they're able to drive transaction volumes. And eventually, I would expect, as Indonesia moves and develops and certainly matures, we'll see other financial products on these wallets as well, like loans and wealth management, insurance, et cetera. So just to finish, to wrap up here and summarize in the last minute or so, where should incumbents prioritize because of all this? I think one is to understand, track the activity of super apps to understand where there's this risk of disintermediation. As we see these marketplaces evolve based on these wallets, I think a lot of banks as well as asset managers, insurance companies will be putting their products on these platforms. If we look at companies like where Tencent and Ant Financial are investing and partnering, a lot of activity in Southeast Asia, a lot of activity in Latin America and some other parts of the world. But emerging markets is certainly where this is really taking hold today because of a lot of the forces at play. And I think another area to think about is also understanding how disintermediation also can create customer acquisition and cross-sell opportunities. So as super apps look to seek bank and insurance partners for some of these marketplaces that they're offering, I think there will also be opportunities for banks to offer other products to them. We've already seen this take place in some cases, like in Southeast Asia, where banks can leverage that user acquisition from some of the wallets and then bring them into other products and add a lot of new customers through these platforms as well. And I think also concentrating lastly on the opportunities based on where these super apps are in that flywheel sort of playbook is really important. If you look at an example like Invesco, for example, they've added about $14 billion in assets for their China joint venture just in the last few months, viewing it certainly as a major opportunity. And so as we see sort of the wallets develop and emerge and shift their strategy from not just driving transaction and consumption, but as economy like China today, where people are now investing into wealth management products, insurance products, protection products, there's opportunities for incumbents to also take advantage of that, add a lot of assets as well as new customers. And I think we're starting to see a lot of incumbents already do that today. So I'm going to wrap up. We're going to turn over to Cameron, who will introduce TOS. We also have some additional research that we've been putting out on some of these themes and topics. I'd be happy to discuss them with all of you later at the conference as well today. So thank you very much, and look forward to the next talk.